Let me first say to Michael that, I think you should get a new agent if you're having trouble finding someone who will translate your book into English, because this is a very hot topic. And the person, the editor who looked at your manuscript, so they may not know about Gazprom, but you'd be surprised how many people do in this country. So anyway, that's it's probably for those of us who've been working on Russia, one of the most interesting things, certainly since Gorbachev. What I'm going to do is, I hope famous last words be very brief, but look at the claims that Russia has made and various authorities have made about Russia as a reliable energy supplier. You find this really kind of like the basic doctrine. For example, Alexander Medvedev, who's the deputy chairman of Gazprom, in February last year said, the Kremlin did not use energy supplies as a political weapon. Well, you don't have to be Ukrainian to challenge that, but it does help. It's certainly not the case. In January, he said, if you take the long view, you see that we have been a supplier to Europe for over 30 years, and there hasn't been a single occasion when we didn't fulfill our contractual obligations. Anyway, that's the two statements. And then Shuvalov, who is the economic counselor to Putin, said Europe will never have a more reliable supplier of energy than Russia. And then finally, another statement, the Russian Federation has always abided by all of its obligations fully and completely and will continue to do so. So this is a continual litany, and it makes a very nice target to go after. So that's what I've done. Let's see, what is actually the case? Now, some of this, of course, predates the breakup of the Soviet Union, but the Soviet Union, the Soviets, and the Russians have used energy as probably one of their strongest economic tools. I document over a dozen cases in my book where I had an agent where this was the case. So you go back, take petroleum, Yugoslavia, when they got angry with Tito, when Tito was getting frisky, cut off the flow. Israel, after it invaded the Sinai. Finland, for a variety of reasons. Then China, when they got angry with Mao. Latvia, now in the more current period, now we're talking, we're getting close to this Latvia, when the Latvians were talking about independence in that period right before the Soviet Union broke up. Then Lithuania, for the same reason. But then, of course, more recently, when this is now petroleum, of course, when Lithuania has a refinery that it wanted to sell to an American firm, the flow of petroleum was cut off through the pipeline that was feeding that refinery. And then most recently, Estonia, when the Estonians were moving statues around. So, kind of political issues that aren't all that fundamental in some cases, that certainly does happen. And I should just add now, more recently, and I've not put it in this, because these were political reasons. There's an economic reason. Lukoil, of all things, which after all has 20% ownership of ConocoPhillips, has suspended the sale of petroleum to Germany, which is for me quite a bit of a shock. I take this for granted, but for commercial reasons, Lukoil in particular, which is very heavily influenced by private commercial reasons that they should cut off the flow to Germany, does come, I say, as quite of a surprise. So now in the case of gas, well, this is a more recent phenomenon, and this is what happens with after the breakup of the Soviet Union, when, as you've heard this morning, the pipeline goes in one direction to Gazprom and some of the gas fields end up in Central Asia and elsewhere. But among those countries that have been affected by with the cutoff of gas, you've heard of two, Ukraine and Belarus this morning, but also Georgia and Moldova have also been affected. A pipeline in Georgia blew up when the Georgians began to carry on. which again is a way of influencing it. Now, what about the future? What does this portend about the future? Well, it's not just that they want to control the inflow, the pipeline, and Eastern Europe, or the former Soviet Union, but I see them going way beyond that. And I'll just go through the list. What they're doing is not just a case of delivering the gas to the country, to Western Europe, but what they're trying to do in a very systematic way is gain control, or at least some influence over the delivery of the gas within the country to the consumer, both industrial and households. And I'll have some words to say about the significance of that later. But it's almost as if, I've not seen it written anywhere, but somebody said, here are the Ten Commandments, this is what Gazprom expects to do, but it's doing it. And if you go back and you look country by country, you can see that. Now, somebody said this morning that in the case of Italy, the parliament refused to let Gazprom into the household. Whoever said that, I would really love to see the documentation. That it may be the case. I'm not saying it isn't happening, but everything I see recently suggests that Eni in particular, which is the Italian energy company, which has a long history of dealing with Soviet and Russian energy, is already in partnership and joint ventures. In any case, Russia is delivering already 3 billion cubic meters of natural gas to Italy through Eni, but the total that they're already supplying is about 20 billion cubic meters, which is a substantial amount. In the case of France, they're already delivering 500 million cubic meters to industrial users directly from the Gazprom pipeline, now internal domestic pipelines in control as well. In the case of Germany, well, there are all kinds of these joint ventures that are going on and are being talked about. So far, at the present time, Germany is, of course, Russia's largest customer, 35 billion cubic meters a year. With joint ventures where the Russians may not always have more than 50% of the activity, but come close to it, which gives them a very important say. Now, what's the goal? The goal is to increase that. The goal for the United Kingdom, you know, you're separated now by a water body, but there's a pipeline going from the Netherlands to Great Britain. By 2011, Gazprom wants to supply, or Russia wants to supply, 14% of the gas that's used by small business in Great Britain. In the case of France, the goal by 2011 is 12% of all the gas consumed, 25 billion cubic meters. For those of us in the United States who we kind of watch this game going on, isn't it fun? We don't have to worry about it. Well, it turns out we are very much involved as well. It's not just that Lukoil has bought up Getty Oil gasoline stations. If you drive up and down the East Coast, you will see where there used to be Getty stations. Now, increasingly, they're being converted into Lukoil. But also in terms of natural gas, we are already supporting about over $8 billion worth of natural gas from Russia, which is a pretty good trick given the fact that they don't have the ability to make LNG yet. But what is happening, we're involved in swap agreements, and so the gas we get from Jamaica is offset, or from Algeria is offset by gas that Gazprom gives to the Algerians or the Jamaicans in Europe. But in any case, the goal by 2014 is that 1% of the gas that we will consume in the United States will come from from Russia. Now, you have to understand that natural gas, we're quite self-sufficient. And what we don't have, as opposed to in petroleum, where we're about 50% dependent on imports, what we don't have also then comes from Canada. So between Canada and the United States, our own sources, we're pretty safe when it comes to natural gas. So to be able to pick up 1% of the natural gas is quite an achievement. Where else are the Russians involved now in distributing, taking over domestic pipelines? Ukraine, one of the big fights, of course, going on is that the Russians want ownership of the pipeline there. And that's that, I would just add. Okay, well, let me, believe it or not, try to bring this to a close. what should we do? What should our policy be? How you know, because it is a political weapon, a very effective political weapon, particularly natural gas. Well, as far as I'm concerned, I would advocate that we encourage the Russians to sell us all the petroleum that they have, because that's relatively easy to substitute. If the Russians cut it off, if something happens to Lukoil, well, we may have trouble finding a substitute, particularly if they line themselves with suppliers from the Middle East. But at least you're not tied to that particular pipeline. That's the critical thing. There are alternate pipelines. There are tankers. There are railroad trucks, railroad cars. There are trucks. So there, you can get your petroleum in a variety of ways. Gas is a different kind of thing. Unless you've got an LNG facility. And to have an LNG facility, both either shipping it and receiving it, you're still dealing with billions of dollars. You don't have it. It's very difficult to have a standby, almost impossible financially to have a standby supply of natural gas if the supplier cuts you off, where that's not the case with petroleum. So that's the important consideration. I say LNG gives you some flexibility, but again, it's not easy. And if you look at what goes on here in Boston, even when we get LNG, we're not happy about it, because we're getting now some from Jamaica that comes into Everett. It goes into Boston Harbor, and we don't like it there, not in my backyard. The whole thing could blow up, particularly with terrorism. So we want to put it out in Boston Harbor, but they want to destroy the natural beauty of Boston Harbor. So even if you get it, it's such a potentially explosive issue in terms of being really a dangerous element. It's difficult to do. Ronald Reagan, bless his heart, understood this in a way that I don't think I appreciated at the time. Remember, if you go back and look in the Soviet period, he was doing everything he could to sabotage the building of a pipeline from the Soviet Union to Germany. He understood that this was an important political tool that the Russian Soviets would have with Western Europe, particularly as we've seen both January 2006 and January 2007, and we're seeing potentially right as we speak that the Russians would cut off the flow of gas. It's not January now, but it's still pretty cold. You picked that time to do it. Anyway, to calm Reagan, the Germans agreed that they would limit their consumption of natural gas, or their import of natural gas, reliance on natural gas from Russia to 25%. Well, good luck. It's now up to 40%. 40% of the natural gas, which is an incredibly powerful tool for the Russians to exercise. 40% of the gas that Germany imports comes from Russia. For Europe as a whole, for Western Europe as a whole, it's 25%. And if you look at Eastern Europe, Finland, and most of the East European countries, it's 100%. So what I would just end with by saying is that I think we all agreed that you've got to look elsewhere. One of the kind of sobering things that the European Union is saying, well, we understand there's a problem. We've got to look elsewhere, and we've got to restrain ourselves from consuming natural gas. I don't know anyone who has been able to do that. You can say those things, but there aren't many alternatives out there. God distributed natural gas deposits in very strange places that don't always suit us, are not politically acceptable in all cases. And there aren't many elsewheres. I mean, that's the point I'm trying to make. And once you begin to consume, as in the case of the Germans, who they said, well, we'll limit it to 25%, you get up to 40%. It's like a narcotic. And you can't curb it. And so politically, this is probably going down the home stretch, one of the strongest weapons, certainly economic weapons, that the Russians have, and I would argue political weapons as well.